So, what is the history of Halloween? Daniel Phillips is a ghost hunter from Sydney and joins us now. Daniel, good morning.
Good morning. How are you?
You run ghost tours around Sydney.
Yes, I do. Well, particularly on the North Shore.
And obviously, it's a big time, isn't it?
Absolutely.
Around Halloween, because people get into the mood.
Totally.
In terms of the history of Halloween, it predates most other things that we celebrate, doesn't it?
Absolutely. Well, it comes originally from a Celtic end of harvest festival, or their Celtic New Year, a time when they believed that the physical world and the spiritual world would come together, and good spirits and bad spirits could then come and wander.
So there's like a crossover in the void, and the spirits can come. And they did believe, didn't they, that the spirits could potentially come and inhabit your body.
Absolutely. And this is part of the reason for the costuming. Basically, it was a case of they didn't want an evil spirit to possess your body. So by dressing up as a ghoul, it's like, say, no vacancy here.
Yeah, I've already been possessed.
Yeah, you know, sorry.
Go find someone who looks nice. So trick-or-treating, how did trick-or-treating come about?
Ironically, that's actually developing from a Scottish thing, in that Scottish youths used to go from house to house going, saying, give me food and alcohol, or I'm going to put your family carriage up on, you know, bricks or whatever. Mm. And as a result, what would happen is that most people say, I don't need the trouble, so here's some food and alcohol.
Yeah, yeah. The interesting thing is quite often that there are religious groups who are against it because they believe it's evil. But in reality, it is a non-religious celebration or festival anyway, isn't
it? Pretty much. I mean, if you go and look at Michael Jackson's Thriller, saying, like, I don't believe in ghouls, but I'm going to dress up as a ghoul anyway.
Yeah.
It's just basically a bit of fun.
Now, you're constantly putting yourself around people who want to be frightened, but they're frightened to be frightened. That's the nature of fear. Mm-hmm. What is it that people gravitate towards fear? They love it.
I think people like the adrenaline rush that comes after having had a good fun scare. And if you can go out and laugh about it at the same time, that really works.
So you have, I mean, often you'll have a group of people, and you'll be in a graveyard or something like that, and you present history.
Yeah.
You must have in every group people who have a different threshold for fear.
Absolutely.
So some of them obviously want you to go the whole hog, and others are just about to wet themselves.
Absolutely. So it's like any group, you pace it as to what's going to work for an individual person. And I must admit, depending on the reactions of the group, I will tell different stories to different groups based on how they react.
You've said an interesting thing, because we were talking before, and you said an interesting thing that I had an author say to me once.
Yeah.
I said to an author, I said, you know, do people believe these things that you put in the book? Because they're so unbelievable. Mm-hmm. And he said to me, he said, if I told the truth, no one would believe it, because the truth is less believable than my fiction. And that is true with your horror stories, isn't it?
Yes.
A lot of them are far too horrifying to actually tell.
Well, I often have to go and understate the truth, because if you go and tell it exactly as it was, people are going to go, oh, that couldn't have possibly happened. And that happens sometimes on my tours.
Who's the perhaps scariest, most gruesome ghost in Sydney?
There are definitely some. One that actually comes to mind is Henry Barcroft Boak, who hung himself around Folly Point. His body wasn't found till 8 days after he was declared missing. And the people who own the land where he hung himself believe that he's coming through the house and rearranging things.
And does he?
Well, you'd have to ask the owner of the house.
See, I've got to ask you, do you believe in ghosts?
I used to be a full-blown cynic at one stage, and I still believe that about 98% of things that are called ghostly can be ruled out by process of elimination or logic. But that still leaves that 1 in 50 that you can't explain. And I think whatever you're left with, however improbable, is what you're left with.
And it's the magic, isn't it? And that's what Halloween's all about, keeping the magic alive. Brilliant. Thank you so much, Daniel, for joining us. Thank you for dressing up. This is the outfit you use to roam through graveyards.
Well, I'm usually a little bit less understated, but I decided to get in for the occasion.
Daniel Phillips, thank you so much for joining us.
Thank you.
If you see a man dressed like that wandering through a graveyard, you know, it
be scared.
Either is Daniel.
Be very scared.
Or it isn't.
Yeah.
Do you believe in ghosts? I believe in ghosts.
Well, I don't know. I was going to ask, are ghosts the same as spirits? Because I believe in spirits.
Yeah, then you believe in ghosts.
Okay.
Oh, and then there's poltergeists. Apparently poltergeists can move things.
They were in Ghostbusters,
right? So a ghost would go to pick that up, and its ghostly hand would go right through it. So they can't really cause you much harm. But a poltergeist could get that and bash you over the head with it.